Welcome, everybody. Come rain or shine, we have Conversations and Coffee on Thursdays, noon to 1, here at the facility of the Cultural Arts Center, which, of course, is part of the Recreation and Parks, the Columbus Recreation and Parks. And this department celebrates art in every form, especially arts for the public. And as we come together, we say, Stephen, Takacs, thank you for applying to be part of this incredible show. You've caused me to think a lot, to look a lot, and celebrate photos of my family that go back 100 years, and also my past that has the Brownie camera. Would you believe it? Oh, I can see from the faces. Yeah, you're old enough to have the Brownie camera. I'm Ellen O'Shaughnessy, and I coordinate this Conversations and Coffee program. And Stephen and I have had a great conversation, speaking of conversation, on the phone and this morning. And Stephen has told me that his expression of art came from being in the 10th grade at the Fort Hays Career Center, encouraged by mentors, one in particular. And he said, you know, it was a vocational program, and I just loved to get out of the classroom. It just seems how congruent with what he's been doing in traveling all over the country and capturing the spirit of people. So he was encouraged by his professors to get out of the classroom. And you continued and pursued your artistic career, and you went to a number of schools. Tell us about it, and as you do, tell us how to pronounce your name in Hungarian. It has such soul to it. And, you know, I can say when I was in Ireland, they'd say, O'Shaughnessy, what's that? Your name is O'Shaughnessy. And I say the same to Stephen. Let's hear it. How do we say your name in Hungarian?
Takacs.
Doesn't that have soul?
In English, you say Takacs. You've got kind of a Midwestern twang to it. Thank you, Ellen.
Oh, you're very welcome, and we look forward to this.
Are you saying we have a twang?
You know, there's nothing wrong with it. I have the twang, too. Yeah, it's fine. It's great. So thank you all for coming. Once again, my name's Stephen Takacs, or Takacs, but saying that, if there's any Hungarians in the crowd, you're probably wincing, because I'm probably mispronouncing it, quite honestly. So today I'm going to talk about the Brownie In Motion Project, which is on display all around you right now, as well as some earlier projects that kind of led to this, to help give you some context. So Brownie In Motion that you see right here, this large box, is a portable art installation. It's a working camera and darkroom. So when I say working camera, I mean everything in this room, all the black and white images you see around you, were actually shot with this camera and developed inside. It's a very physically involved process of making. I actually am, you know, manually processing everything. I'm working as the shutter mechanism for the camera that lets the light in. And the film advance as well. Kind of all these parts sort of working inside of it. So though I often identify as a photographer, I'm very much a three-dimensional maker as well, as you can see here. This was in no small part to the college I went to for my undergraduate degree, the Oregon College of Art and Craft, where I studied woodworking, metalsmithing, papermaking, in addition to photography. So attending there kind of helped grow my appreciation of history and of craft. These are things that were already kind of my interests, but it really grew that. And while I was there, I began sort of dissecting the camera, how it worked, how technical innovation sort of changed the type of pictures we make and how we, as people in front of the camera, kind of respond to that. It was kind of fascinating to look at the history of photography, and we go from, you know, portraits that are very stiff to things that are loose, more looser, you know, just based on the technology, how sensitive the film was, how large the camera was, these sorts of things. Yes.
I mean, would you like set up somewhere and have them come to you?
It depends. Sometimes.
Can you repeat the question so we can hear you?
Oh, yeah. Can you, will you speak into this?
While he was lugging this around, if he set up a location and then had people come to have their pictures taken. That's what I was wondering.
Well, oftentimes I would move around. So like, for example, like these images on this wall, which were all taken in Wyoming this fall while I was at an artist residency, I showed up at this rope and saddle making shop and sort of did the dance, so to speak, to kind of to convince them to give me permission to spend time there and photograph and interview people. So I was quite literally, you know, set up in the back room of this tack and saddle shop for about a week. There's actually an image on behind the wall over there, the Keller image, where you'll see it kind of set up within that space. All the images in the front entrance of the gallery are all, you know, places I've traveled to with it and photographed at.
So that's inside a mall. Is that inside a mall?
That image is shot inside of a hotel in Lincoln, Nebraska. I had brought it to a photographic photo conference that was happening out there, the Midwest Society for Photographic Education, and was sort of just sharing the project there. The image you see when you first walk into the Cultural Arts Center was also taken there at sort of the main lobby of the hotel. So, yeah, just to reiterate, all the images out front are sort of, you know, places I've been with it, and then what you see around you here in this room are images that were created with this camera. But the intention with this project was not always, I didn't ever expect this when I first started. The idea for this piece behind me was originally as an art installation. While I was in school and after school, I started, I worked with large format cameras. So, you know, the old style camera you would use on a tripod and get behind a dark cloth to focus your image. And when you're focusing and composing an image like that, you're doing it on a large piece of frosted glass. The image light comes through the lens, projects onto the glass on the back, and then you adjust your focus and controls. And I was always taken with just like the beauty of that image, like the luminescence, you know, the look of that. And I wanted to create a work that would sort of highlight that, allow people to experience that in a larger way. And that is sort of how this idea came about. I wanted to create a camera obscura for people to enter inside of and experience.
Did you make this? It looks like it would have been a big job.
It was a big job.
You did it yourself.
Yeah, I had some help. I'm going to be getting to that. But yeah, you know, we get by with a little help from our friends, right? So if you go in there right now, you know, if someone was inside there right now, you would there's a piece of fabric, and you would see yourself, see you guys projected onto that piece of fabric inside of there. Might not be the brightest since we're inside today. Outside is really when that sort of shines. I don't know why that slide moved. So like right here, this is a digital photograph of a projection on the fabric inside of the camera. This was on a city street. That was a print I made later from a negative I exposed inside the camera. And you know, this was a very long process. Like any large projects that are a lot of work, there's a lot of trial and error. And when I, the first version of this, which I made in grad school, was out of drywall and 2x4s, and it was impossible to move. It tried to prove, it showed proof of concept that this could work, but it was really, you know, aesthetically it wasn't really there. It was functionally quite challenging as well. And I ultimately, I scrapped it for several years until the time was right. So Ellen asked, did anyone have a Brownie camera growing up or use one or have experience with those? Yeah, so you know, Brownies were around for a really long time, like 60 some years. And they were one of the first cameras that were, you know, really made for the consumer, made to be accessible. You know, you would take the pictures, send the camera into Kodak, or you know, send the film into Kodak, they'd process it. And was made to be very easy, inaccessible. And I liked that history of accessibility. I wanted to kind of use that idea with this project. That's why I modeled it after a Kodak Brownie. I wanted this idea to, for anyone to sort of be able to get inside of it, to experience it, to understand it.
I got a Brownie in 1942 for my 10th birthday, and I still have the pictures I took with it.
Yeah? where was I? So, as I said, you know, this started in a very rough form, and it got scrapped. And you know, some years later, the idea kept coming back, and I wanted to pursue it further. And I saw a call for entries from Ingenuity Cleveland, which is like a art and music festival that happens every year in Cleveland. And they were looking for installations. So I had applied, and thankfully they accepted my proposal. And I was able to get some funding to kind of make it happen. And at the time I was teaching at Ohio State and became involved in a faculty group called the OSU Steam Factory. And we were working on a grant for the group and kind of opened it up for individuals in the group to submit proposals. So I sort of piggybacked my proposal, kind of rewrote my proposal and submitted it. And that's really how this was able to be made. And but it was a very long process of sort of figuring it out. I knew solid walls was not the way to go. I wanted to be able to transport it, so I made models out of PVC and fabric, kind of settling on more of a tent-like design. And so I did have a lot of help. It's my friend Brittany, she's teaches fashion design at CCAD and has an alteration business, Nine Stitches, on the side. And I was able to get her to help me out. I sewed the model, but really that proved also that I'm not very good at sewing. So thankfully, she came aboard to help me out, and then my friend Sarah as well. It was, you know, very much a collaboration. I got was assisted by some folks at the Columbus Idea Foundry, laser cutting this fabric that you see here, which was then all sewn, you know, onto the vinyl. So after this long, long process, it debuted at Ingenuity Cleveland as this installation. and was a big success. People seemed to really enjoy it, enjoy interacting with it. And at the time, I was set up so people would sit on a bench in front of it, and their friends could go inside and see this large projected image of them on a scrim inside the camera. But, you know, I'm a photographer, so once it was built, I was like, how do I make images with this? Became the next challenge. And so I began kind of trying to figure it out. My first attempts, I used a PVC pipe to try to make a holder to put film, big pieces of film or photo paper in, much like an old film developing tank. This had mixed results. I couldn't always, the paper would always stick to itself. So I tried putting construction fencing in between it to allow the chemicals to come through, and that didn't always work out right. As you see on this image, we've got all this almost like perforated pattern on this gentleman's face. So ultimately, as I'm trying to figure out how do I make photos with this, I came up with sort of a tray method. I found out the results were much more consistent. So meaning, take the piece of paper or film, submerge it into a bath, and just process it like you would a piece of photo paper in a darkroom. But how do I do that if I'm taking this out in the field? I found an old utility cart and ended up installing a drain into it. And that's basically, like, that goes on the road with me whenever I'm out shooting. This cart becomes a giant sink. And there's a drain there, and then there's another attachment here with a ball valve, so I can dump a bucket of chemistry in there, develop, drain the bucket, put the next chemical in, the stop bath, or water is what I usually use. Drain that, fix it, and wash it, like you would in a normal dark room. Ray. Oh, hold on, I'm supposed to give everyone the microphone.
This is a bit of an inside baseball kind of question. You have developer, and then you have a certain amount of time that you sit the picture in developer, and then you have to get it into stop bath fairly quickly, I should assume. I can't imagine you have time to drain and refill a bucket before you've overdeveloped.
You'd be surprised. you know, this is I'm shooting one of a kind images. It's not like you're printing in a like doing an addition in a darkroom. You're trying to get everything exactly the same. So you've got some play there.
So you're exposing on the paper.
Yes, I am largely exposing onto paper. I have used orthofilm as well, which, sorry if this goes over other people's head, we've got some other fellow photo nerds in the crowd here. So yeah, I use ortho on occasion, which is sort of a high contrast print film, but if you use a dilute developer, you can you know, get pretty decent results. Most of the images that you see in here were, I think, everything on that wall except the middle image were all shot on a direct positive paper, meaning when I process it, it is the final picture. It's like shooting a big Polaroid or a Tintype or something like that. The other images that weren't shot that way in the show were shot on RC photo paper, which produces a negative, which then I have to print in the darkroom. It's a contact printing process. So like the portraits on this wall over here were all RC contact prints. Yes, sir?
How big can you make images that as big as you make it?
It's possible to make images as large as the camera, but developing is an absolute nightmare.
You need the bigger tank, right? To put the thing in. The bigger the camera, the bigger the film, the bigger the... Do you get better deep like the old tin types, do you get better images?
I mean, that's all arguable. I would like to say so, but you know, other people might fight me on that.
Look at the old tin types. I actually see something more than I do with the more modern film after the tin types. Something about that is like, you can actually see their soul. You know, and after that, it's just like something, you got an image. But back then, they had to be so still, you could actually see every hair, pores, everything, you know. This was amazing for a tintype.
Well, look at the show, and then you can tell me how successful I am at that.
That was beautiful, you know. That was great. I'm just comparing to tintypes, to regular film, and then we got the digital cameras and beyond.
Yeah, I mean, the different formats can really affect, you know, the types of images we make, which I was starting to touch on a little bit earlier. You know, this, I can't run and gun. This isn't for quick snapshots. I'm kind of stuck. I'm pretty stationary. And so it does affect the type of image I make. And there's a certain amount of waiting involved if you're sitting or standing for a portrait. As Sue Kavanaugh may know, sometimes it can be a little uncomfortable. Just kind of that process of waiting.
You know, I just notice a lot of people, they think they're with their little phones anymore, click, click, click. But I see the people with the old Pentax and all that with the film camera. They actually take it a little bit more seriously. They make art out of the camera. You know, because I kind of like the film thing up to a certain point. I think that's great. But the, it seems like the digital age with all the little cards and all that stuff has just made it, it's like it was art and now it's there and now it was a whole science before that, you know, with the tintypes.
Well, I think it's really, they're all tools. Camera's a tool for the image maker. You know, a lot of serious photographers in the 1890s hated the Brownie. Like, once the Brownie came out, they hated that. And like the Kodak that came out in like 1888, they hated that. Because like they weren't serious, they're not using a tripod, for goodness sake. You know, their images are soft and fuzzy. And you know, that a lot of people didn't like that. It's, you know, photography is it's wed to technological innovation and change. You know, formats have changed, you know, throughout time. You know, there's wonderful work being made digitally now. There's lots of blah work being made digitally, but there was lots of wonderful work made on film and lots of blah work made on film as well.
where did you get your lenses? Are those actually from a camera, or did you have somebody make you some lenses?
This particular lens I bought at a shop a couple years ago in Oregon. It was an old view camera lens that has, you know, pretty wide coverage. Particularly as I move closer to my subject, the throw is really big. It can create a really large image circle, particularly for close-ups.
So you have two lenses, and that's why your image is upside down?
No, this is, like when I'm using it, it's used one lens at a time. Okay. Whenever an image, the light comes through a lens, it flips upside down. And that's what's happening in all of our cameras. You know, when we're shooting on film, we just turn the negative around when we print it. And you wouldn't know. If you're looking through an SLR camera, you know, a digital or film-based camera, light's coming in, bouncing off a mirror, and going through a prism, which corrects for our eyes.
Is the photographic paper, it has to be kept out of the light, so how do you keep it not exposed until you open and close the lens?
I have like a black portfolio case with paper in black plastic bags. So there's sort of two layers of protection.
And so when it's totally dark in there, you pull a sheet out, put it in a holder, evidently.
Yes.
Then open and close the lens manually?
Yeah, pretty much. It's basically removing the lens cap and putting it back on. Right now, if you would walk behind the camera obscura, you'd see curtains, which I kind of always put those on.
It keeps the light from coming in the back.
It helps. You know, for this installation right now, people are welcome to come inside. So we just have the curtains. But if I was actually shooting with it, there's another flap that goes on top. If you look just above the curtains, kind of on the inside, there's a hidden zipper. And there's a whole other flap that zips on, and then I get kind of clamped in there.
So it's closed even the ground, even the floor is closed in, like you're in a bubble?
Yeah, I want to make it as dark as possible so the film or the paper that I'm using isn't exposed to light and ruined before I can shoot it.
Do you have a light meter or something you use to control the exposure? Because doing it manually would be very easy to get overrun and exposed. Or you just count 4, 3, 2, 1 with the lens back on. How do you do that?
It's pretty much counting. Sometimes I'll use a light meter to help me get closer to determining what my exposure should be, but particularly if I'm like in a period where I'm shooting a lot, shooting with it really often, I kind of don't use it as much. But really, inside a room like this, I'd probably try to meter because it's a fairly dark room compared to outside, so it'd be a bit longer exposure. Most of the exposures tend to be like for portraits, I try to keep it around like 2-3 seconds, something like that, so people aren't waiting too long. Yes?
I'm interested in knowing about the motivation to kind of preserve things that have passed, the taxidermist and the leather worker and all of that. Can you talk about that a little bit, why you chose that subject matter?
Yeah, absolutely. I was thinking about the world now, how so often we interface through screens and computer screens, cell phone screens, like iPads, different tablets and things. And more and more, you know, a lot of people, particularly younger people, aren't sort of used to working with their hands, physically experiencing sort of physicality. And, you know, thankfully we're here right now at the Cultural Arts Center where people are very involved in making stuff with their hands, but you know, this is a gem. And with this sort of move away from sort of physical touch and making, I wanted to kind of highlight people that were still continuing to make. And for me, I'm a full-time freelancer. Like, I kind of make my living like shooting photographs largely digitally, as well as assisting other photographers, on their shoots. But I have this background, you know, working in the darkroom. I kind of started in photography as, digital was sort of coming up. The darkroom was still there, but it was sort of beginning to transition. So I sort of started with a strong background in both. And over time, we've seen, sort of digital photography and digital imaging sort of take over. And this project's a way for me to kind of continue that tradition and continue that practice. Just like the people that I photograph are continuing, their practice. Whew. Hot mic.
Can you tell us a little bit about some of the people?
Absolutely. Yes.
What do you think that the young kids looking at your camera, what's their response to you looking at this type of technology? Because they've been around, push button, and there it is.
Well, I think it's kind of a mixed response. I think some people are taken with it. It is a sort of a curiosity, right? This is not sort of something you would normally experience in your day-to-day life. And so I think there's a fair number of people that are, you know, young people that are taken with it, interested in it, you know, want to learn more about it. You know, some people might just want to take a picture with Instagram, though.
It's thinking of the engineering that you had to go through and the process you had to go through, because kids, they don't know the process that you have to go through to make something today. And all the models and stuff to actually get it done where you are right now. A lot of them just think push a button, and
a lot of adults don't know either.
Yeah. I'm interested in the people too, and maybe you when you're talking about the people, maybe like, what was your favorite when you brought this contraption in and did what is documented all these photos? What was like one of your favorite times, one of your favorite people that you had?
TV guys will appreciate it.
I was reiterating the question here about, you know, talking about some of the people that are captured here and the process of bringing in the brownie and setting it up and taking the images. Like, maybe tell us one of your favorite stories of a person or a place.
Okay. Let's see. I'll probably direct your attention over to that wall again. As I said, you know, all these images except the landscape were all shot at the same location at King's Saddlery in Sheridan, Wyoming, while I was on an artist residency in the fall. And this was like a really unique opportunity for me. A lot of times when I go to photograph somebody for this project, like Bill Moore here, you know, I showed up at his house, we set up the camera in his backyard, outside his wood shop, and made some images. But ultimately, at the end of the day, I had to pack it all back up, put it in the van, and then move on. Which was great, and you know, Bill's an amazing person, he's a phenomenal wood turner. he's in Portland, Oregon. But the opportunity I had there at King's was actually to sort of stay there and kind of do a sustained study, which was really wonderful. I felt like I became one of the employees there after a while. I was coming in every day for like a week straight. Granted, I didn't punch the clock exactly at 9 o'clock. I'd usually roll in a little bit later. But you know, there was this ongoing dialogue between myself and the other folks that worked there. So, you know, there was a variety of leather workers there. They make saddles, wallets, and different things, as well as rope. They're like known worldwide for their like rope for like rodeos. And, you know, it's a surprisingly, you know, very long, in-depth process to get the rope just right for, say, roping cattle and things like that. And, you know, that kind of gave me an opportunity to really to learn about it more. And you know, just keep kind of exploring in different ways. So photographing saddles over there, like those, the three images that are stacked vertically, those are all detailed shots of really kind of amazing leather, like tooling work, saddles. And you know, I could spend a whole day or day and a half just shooting those.
Find inspiration that day of what to document, or did you kind of like map out the whole, you know, the days or weeks that you were there? Did you have it all? Did you go to one part one day and another one, or how did you find your inspiration?
I can say it wasn't quite mapped out.
I
winged it.
David was right.
I want to fix that.
On your pictures, or at least this one and some of the others I saw, the depth of field is very shallow. Is that a product of the lens itself, or the amount of time that you keep the lens cap off?
There's, you know, several factors involved. because, like, doing portraits of people, I want to try to keep that exposure time down as much as I can. So I open up the aperture of my lens as much as possible, pretty much, to just kind of focus on them or, you know, something in the scene to cut my exposure time down. If I wanted a greater depth of field, I'd the stop down and the exposure would increase exponentially.
Do you have any trouble getting people to pose for you?
I've been pretty lucky. I mean, I usually don't set it up unless I have something lined up or I have a good feeling about a place. I do have a funny story.
Are you interested in, since obviously you're doing, you know, the antique caterpillar salaries, so do you find things, obviously shooting some older stuff, kind of like, you know, obviously tying it with tintype, you know, 1800s, early 1900s, you know, take the technology using the time it came from? Are you interested in those kinds of things? I mean, opportunities I have with the asking about it.
Yeah, I'm definitely interested in history and how that can kind of play into the project.
I know somebody, I think I have one that'd be kind of cool.
Check. All right. I just lost track. What was I going to say? Oh, so generally, whenever I set this up, I've got a picture in mind I want to make. In this instance, I wasn't even that dead set on making a photograph of Mount Rushmore. I just wanted to get a photograph of the project in front of Mount Rushmore. And when I showed up, I had talked to the parking attendant. It's like, I have this large camera I want to set up. I tried to be clear. I don't think I was clear enough. It's like, where can I set this up where I will be out of the way? I don't want to cause any problems here. I want to make some photos. Where should I go? So they send me to the farthest parking lot away. Fine, I'm totally fine with that. We start setting it up. I was traveling with my friend Micah, and we set up the camera. And just as we kind of put this outside shell onto the frame, this man on a golf cart rolls up and just starts screaming at me, who was head of the parking division and was concerned. He was just concerned. And I tried talking to him, and he was just not wanting to reason with me. And he's like, says, I'm going to report you to a ranger. It's like, please, I would rather talk to, in my head, I'm thinking, I'd much rather talk to a ranger than you. Please. So he zoomed off on his golf cart. A little while later, a ranger showed up in a truck. And there was, again, this negotiation that happened, this dance. And I was able to convince him that this is art. It's okay. I'm an instructor at Ohio State. I'm working on a project. It's all right.
Well, there are art fellowships in the state parks all over the country, and they set them up, and people apply, and so forth. So I'm sure once you said this is an art installation, so you sort of heard about these things and knew that you weren't going to blow up the place. I mean, did he check it out to make sure you didn't have any ammonium nitrate or anything like
that? He didn't go that far. But he looked up my ID, and luckily 614 magazine did an article on me like before I'd gone on that trip, and I had a copy with me, and so that sort of helped legitimize it in his eyes. This kind of glossy looking magazine wrote something about it. He's okay.
Do you always draw a crowd when you set that up?
Sometimes. Sometimes I'll go to lengths not to draw a crowd. But there are times, I guess, that, yes, that is an Embassy Suites.
Oh, yeah.
That's the one I was mentioning earlier in Lincoln, Nebraska. Other times, I guess I purposely draw a crowd. This was at the World Naked Bike Ride here in Columbus. So this is the saddle shop I was working in for about a week, where a lot of these images were made. And, there we'd get questions, it is sort of a tourist destination, but there's a lot of locals that'll stop in and hang out or, pick up things. And so while I was there, I certainly, yeah, people did have questions, and I, you know, was always try to accommodate them accordingly. It was a really nice kind of opportunity to do some work in a focused setting.
You're going to tell us about if you had trouble getting people, how to get people to close for
you. The question was, how do you get people to pose for you? You know, some people want to be seen. Other people don't. Usually, I, you know, find people that want to be seen. Or in this instance, maybe there was a little peer pressure that went on. or really, a development of trust. Going back to the Wyoming pictures here in the saddle shop, you know, initially some of the folks that worked there, like this couple, it took. I was there several days before they were like, "Oh yeah, let's do a picture." Like I kind of had to prove myself, so to speak. Like they could see images as they were sort of coming out throughout the days I was there. And that sort of, you know, they kind of got a better understanding of what I was doing and, you know, what I'm about, and then, you know, agreed to sit.
Did they ignore you? Just sort of, you were the background then, and they were busy working, and then...
Well, absolutely. I mean, they were working. I, you know, if they watched me all day, the boss would probably tell me to get the heck out of there, because, you know, they're still a business. Yeah, I became sort of part of a fixture, so to speak, and it felt like I was sort of like an employee after a while because I'd show up every day.
Yeah. I found when I was taping people that within a few minutes they just ignored the mechanics, the technical part of it, and the machine, and they got into their stories. So I'm sure with the camera too, after a bit, it just becomes background. And so that's the best kind of time to go to that. Right?
Yeah, that's what you hope.
Most relaxed.
And with this, there is this that sense of waiting before a photograph is made, and so that kind of helps break that down a little bit. Whereas, like, maybe if we were shooting digitally, you might be inclined to just shoot a lot to kind of get this...
And be in the way.
So that maybe a subject would start getting used to it. The opposite approach is sort of waiting. For them to get used to, as opposed to, no, there's sort of a yin and yang approach, maybe.
Well, but then they don't get so involved in that image that they begin posing for it or prepare, you know, sort of into this way. They've got to get to other things, and so then when it becomes a new thing. It's surprising and it's interesting, but they don't know when you're taking that photograph if they're busy working. They don't know what instant you are. Do they hear it?
Well, in this instance, they do.
They
know because there's, as someone pointed out, they have kind of a narrow range of focus a lot of times with the images. So they're standing for me.
Okay.
Don't get me wrong.
They're not moving. Okay.
What's that?
In this picture.
Yeah, well, this is sort of a behind the scenes picture. This is, oh. That's what I looked like a couple months ago. That's me. yeah, I decided to shave before I came back home. So that's me. That's one of the saddles that you see over there. And that is Ryan and his son. Ryan's sort of the heir to the king's saddlery empire. It's a family business. It's been like he's like the third generation. So he's actually with his son, who would be the fourth generation. And we were just talking, and they're looking at kind of what I'm doing. So yeah, this is a behind-the-scenes shot that someone else made. This is a picture, well, we see sort of cropped version over there. This is like what a negative looks like. This was just a snap on a, you know, iPad or something of the image in water inside my portable sink. And then this is a digital inversion. This is not a printed version. This is just a in the computer flip.
Do you use strobes on
In these images, yes, I did use strobes. Other instances, I've used hot lights, I've used just ambient light, you know, natural light. Because I was there so long, I did have the opportunity to light everything, which was great. And yeah, kind of opened up different possibilities.
I noticed on one or two of your prints that the writing was backward. What causes that?
That goes back to that question you had earlier. We talked about image being upside down, but it's also laterally reversed when it comes in. It's like a mirror.
Without another lens, it never gets corrected then.
Correct.
If
you go inside of here, you'll see everything upside down and backwards, just like you would if you were looking at an old view camera and making photographs with that. Normally when you shoot with film on a view camera, in the printing process, that all gets flipped back around. On the direct positive photographs, there is no flipping back around.
Right.
It's backwards. Just like a tintype would. If you look at an old 19th century tintype and happen to find one that has text in it, it will most likely be flipped around. It'll be backwards. Question?
So with the negative, you can flip it. Is that what you're saying? With the negative, you can flip it and then print it?
Absolutely, yeah. In the printing process, it gets flipped back around.
So there's not a double lens. You're not flipping and then flipping again with another lens in the Brownie.
I am not.
Stephen, you mentioned in the beginning of your talk that you're a photographer, and for the longest time, photography has had a hard time breaking into the art field. Can you talk a little bit about how you fit in that world with art and photography? An example of that is sometimes in prospectuses for shows, you'll see you may enter a painting, a drawing, sculpture, but not photography. You know, photography is not accepted as an art form. So can you talk about how you kind of fit into this contemporary world as a photographer and what that is versus an artist using photography?
Hmm. Well, if someone's, an organization's not allowing photo to be submitted as art, well, we probably don't even want to deal with them in general because they're stuck in the past. it's true, you know, that was a real debate for a very long time. But I don't really often, I don't really run into that. This, you know, places that I desire to exhibit at.
Do you think the digital aspect has helped that to kind of bring it more kind of commonplace now?
Are you asking me, do I think digital has helped bring photography
to a more commonplace in the art world?
Hmm. I mean, digital photography has definitely made photography even more common in our day-to-day world. I don't know if it necessarily has made it more in the art world. I think it's, you know, being photographic imagery is being used in a wider variety of ways, not just, you know, the straight print, but, you know, within, you know, multimedia and, you know, images we can interact with on screens and different ways like that. But I don't know if it is inherently, you know, made it more so. Where do I fit in? That's a good question. You know, there's lots of different artists will kind of deal with that question. You know, or is it an artist using photography? Is it an art photographer? Is it just a photographer? That's, I don't know. I'm not too interested in getting, like, bogged down in the minutiae of that particularly. I think, you know, we can make without having to put a ton of labels on it. Yes?
What is a print?
What's a silver gelatin print? That's just a traditional print made in a darkroom, meaning it's, you know, a light-sensitive paper, black and white paper, where images was made on. So there's silver in it. Yeah, there's light-sensitive silver salts in the paper. There's a sort of gelatin binder that keeps that all together. There's other components, of course, but that's kind of how photographs were made for a very long time. When you look at the labels here, if you see the ones that say unique, that just means it's a direct positive picture, or it's a one-of-a-kind photograph. But all these in this room are silver gelatin. Yes?
Does that mean they were all taken with a Brownie camera, all these pictures?
Yes, ma'am.
And what was your motivation for using the Brownie camera? Do you think the quality of the pictures is better than the modern-day cameras?
I'm not going to say it's better, it's different. You know, it's, I was kind of saying before, it's part of it is a way for me to kind of continue this tradition of making and, you know, working in a dark room. There's inherently, as I said, it kind of results in a different form of image using something like this to make a photograph. Yes? Well, I don't see this project being done. I want to keep traveling with it. In April, I'm going to be visiting a college in Indiana and doing a presentation and driving out there and spending a little time. I'm currently booking things if anyone wants to bring me out somewhere. But yeah, I want to keep working with it. And I've got other projects in the works too, but you know, I see this as an ongoing thing.
Isn't it hard to get black and white film? And do you do any work in color with the Brownie?
You know, the product I use is largely for this camera is a little difficult. Thanks for coming. difficult to acquire at times. Like, it was in production for a long time, and then it went away for a year, and then it came back. And now the new formula of the paper is a little different. Like, I found it to be a lot less sensitive to light, unfortunately. So I'm hoping it's just the first batches like that, because I'm going to have to, when I re-up, I'm going to have to change my process if that's the case.
Thank you, Steve.
Thank you. Thanks for coming.
And we were talking about things that you were going to do. Okay, you're going to be here for an introduction to digital camera.
Yeah, which is kind of ironic after all this.
I was just thinking, this is great, bringing those two worlds together.
It's, as I said, it's just another tool.
Uh-huh. Saturday, March 12th, 12:30 to 3:30. So, do join us. I was looking at one of the statements that you made. Oh, I thought it was so great. In your artist statement, and you utilize techniques that delay gratification as a personal effort to slow down the process and perceive the world around me. Isn't that beautiful? You know, for some reason or another, my husband showed up. I have no idea why. But I was thinking, he bought me the most beautiful flowers out of the blue yesterday. Well, this morning I'm running around, get ready to be about. And I stopped before those flowers. And I said, you haven't gazed today. You haven't prayed today. Just be. And here I am meeting a mentor calling me to be. So let us leave, travel, and notice, huh? Yeah. Does your mentor from Fort Hayes is?
Rick Cox. He's still around. He couldn't be here today. He's not feeling well, but.
But he's the one who got you out and about, called you to be noticing. And a student, as he was saying, just wanting to get out of the classroom and be about the world. What a wonderful mentor. And we say thank you to him, too, right? All right.